You're being recorded.
Alrighty then. Make sure you got your name in there, man. So you can get in there, Rob.
No.
You might want to get a closer man so you can see that. You like me.
Really, it's just you, man. They are things that are you.
Rob ain't seen it.
No, he said that's what he's saying.
That's what I said.
Oh.
And Billy.
I think I said outside. I haven't seen it either.
Yeah, I saw it. I went through. I did the whole assessment thing.
Yeah, I went ahead and go through the whole report.
So you did get my email that sent you your password?
Yes, I'm 99%
sure.
Yeah, okay.
I'll take my password. That's what I'm getting now.
There's a pen in that drawer right behind.
Yeah, 99% sure I got it.
Which drawers?
No, you
got one right here.
Yeah, and if it's a
ribbon
on there, if not, it's a paper on that card back there.
Hey, brother. Oh, you got one?
Appreciate you.
Is some paper on that card?
No.
Get him a piece of paper, dude. Jack, please.
Oh, let me have some paper.
I don't remember my password.
You need mine?
I might.
Huh?
I might.
There you go, bro. Appreciate it.
Kidney infection, and then your prostate is swollen up.
Yeah, what is your password?
What is it, Jay? Capital C, ATFISH43.
Why are you asking me? I don't know your password.
Yeah, dude. Yeah, that's a long ride by yourself, man.
Yeah, it is, bro.
All right, so I was putting the wrong using that wet patch.
Introduce yourself, sir. I'll edit from this point on.
Really?
Yeah, this is all this goes on the site, man.
Are you going on Facebook Live?
No, this isn't live. It'll be on the chamber.
You know what? That video we did that guy shoot for us, he want to charge me $15 for the video, and now he can't get it.
You mean the guy that came in that one day?
for the cross-pollination committee that we created. The portal is a hub with all the information and to start to do activities and to interact with the facilitators. Everyone will have a login. It's public, but it's only public to those that are actually members and have a login. So the login is way at the portal. It's ILBCCB2B, so Illinois Black Chamber of Commerce, business2business.com. It's the website. So you log in. And when you log in, this is the actual portal. This is the dashboard, the main dashboard. And on the dashboard, you'll see some sponsor links and things like that from some of our sponsors. Then you see these little widgets, projects. We can do polls, so we can poll people to find out what activities that they like best and so forth, things like that. You'll see all the groups, and the groups are directly related to the actual workshops that we have. And then that's where the facilitators and administrators, and they can upload all of their content, like the slide decks and notes and links and websites that they talked about. Then also we have on here certain courses that you could take to check your skills and your understanding of the content and so forth. And then we have, we'll just go through the left side, that's the menu. These are all the groups that we have in here. Today, sales management, which is sales negotiating skills. I believe we did customer service, correct?
Yes.
Yes, mm-hmm. Already. So today on sales management will be about the sales negotiation side. That's what that group is about. All the students will have access to each group. Whatever the instructor decides to put up there will be the content, so some will be, have more content than others, or different types of content, depending on if the instructor wants to use video and so forth. Projects. So projects are things that the instructors can use. I believe Dale Reese and probably myself would be the only ones that use projects, because when I do my workshop, it'll be about digital assessment, so that means I'll be working with each individual person, giving a survey, understanding what your actual state of technology is, and then how we can work with what you actually have to get the best bang or ROI of what you have, and then look at a future state. What do you really, what's your vision, where do you want to go, and how technology can help facilitate that, and then we'll put together a plan, and you'll have some to-dos, and then that's how we'll mark the progress of what you've been doing based on where you say you want to go.
So that means that in Del Reed's case, what do you need to do to get her information in there now, since she's already had her class?
She has to upload it.
She has to upload it. So Billy.
So my slide from the last one, you upload that?
No, he'll get to that, because your slides and stuff are already in there, right?
I believe so.
Yeah.
And here's the directory. And this is the directory of the facilitators we had. And you click on the link, it'll tell you a bit more of like, well, Donnell was the one we did last week, last class on last week. So it tells a little bit about Donnell, how to contact him, profile, location. So pictures I have, I upload. So if it's not a picture, just see the little hoodie. They didn't send me a picture. When is Lindsay's?
I gave you a picture.
You did?
I gave you a bio too.
Yeah, he gave you a picture. Hey, wow, hey,
hey, I sent it to you. Just left me all that long. Slide it in the day.
Huh?
Yep, I did it the day you asked for it. It's the truth. It was coming from.
Why the shit cut off?
No, I'll report it.
I've never seen a holder, a placeholder of a hoodie.
That's what I could find at the time when I was doing it.
Oh, you put that?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought it was the default.
Billy stuff I sent you.
Yes.
That's questionable, but okay.
That ain't questionable because you told me you had it. You were going to put it in.
I don't know if I told you that. I put the stuff I had in there. So the wiki is like a repository of information. So we have articles, videos, all types of things that and anybody can create a wiki, students or facilitators. And these are, you know, just helpful articles, 65 black-owned businesses you should know about, Black Friday, the Black Business List, Buy Black Movement, One Family's Effort to Buy Black for a Year. You know, then we have some samples of a business line, a credit request letter, a personal loan letter, salary loan request letter. So just templates and things that you can use and grab. And we want to create a database of all types of forms and documents that you can actually take and use. Yeah. The file manager is similar, but...
Make sure that you know the workshop videos are deposited there as well.
You missed the workshop, go back.
Just me and you.
Yeah, IBCC workshop video. So we got business plan templates, business letters and agreement templates, helpful articles. Those are the four categories, so they'll be broken up into categories. File manager is a little bit different. We're going to use that for assignments, for things that are due, like if you have a survey that you need to upload, or if there's something in particular.
Brothers and sisters!
More about straight business, so there's certain forms and things that we can put here that every business is going to have a file or use. News. We're looking to keep this as for a strictly a local political news because every entrepreneur should understand what his local politics is about, state politics, regional politics, understand how these things are going to affect your bottom line. A lot of times business owners don't know. They get frustrated like, why am I going to pay all these taxes? What happened here? What happened there? And you can see it coming because there's always something coming. And if you can see it coming, you can sometimes do something about it or prepare, at least prepare yourself for it. To start to brace yourself for those things. We also have an events calendar, and it's, of course, contact us page. That's, you know, if you have a question, this is how you contact us. The bottom is just basically about the wiki articles, how to navigate to the page. But the main thing you're gonna operate from is that dashboard. You do also, you can create your own profiles. Put your own picture up here if you like. You can create your own groups within, you know, the other facilitators. It's not really meant to, it has the capacity to be its own intranet social media hub, but it, you know, it's really no reason to try to replace Facebook and stuff like that. The core of this stuff is to be a hub and repository for this information, all the things that we talk about, document, that we learn, and we can learn from each other. Start to build and everybody can go back to it, share it, and so forth, and then it continue to grow, and it'll be for us, by us, and so forth. So this is the foundation of it, the framework is going to continue to develop and change and build and grow, but that's the gist of it.
Brothers and sisters!
You want to see other things, you know, this is a website, we can recode it, add things that aren't on here, but for the most part, I think the biggest thing is going to be the wiki, the directory actually. You're looking to talk to somebody, what happened, like Dale Reese? What happened to Dale Reese? Oh, I could go to the portal and contact Dale Reese. She talked about a program, and I'm hearing about the program again, because it happens to me a lot. Somebody mentioned something, and I might blow it off. You know, I've been around the circus a few times. Then you hear it from somewhere else, you're like, man, this might be real. Hey, what's that? So and so that. And so this will give you a chance to go back, use that information in the directory to reach out to people. And the wiki will be a good way to access that information. You guys will have a login. I'm not sure if you were on the email. If you were on the email list, that original email list, then you should have a login. Actually, I can just check. If not, we'll just create it and you'll get it. You'll be able to log in. What's your name?
Ronald Spratt.
No, I don't have it. Who?
You know, J.
check your email.
Yeah, I didn't check.
It's like you send me that stuff.
No, I did send that. I know the picture I used and everything. I was looking slick. You know, I was like,
oh, yeah?
Nah.
What's your, you said Ronald?
Yes.
What's the last name?
Spragins, S-P-R-A. G-G-I-N-S.
Email?
C-E-S-L-C. I-N-C. At yahoo.com.
You got Tyler in there?
Password is going to be cross pollination 2017, then you'll be able to change that number. What did you ask?
I said, Tyler again.
Maybe, did somebody else register you?
Yeah, it just says the email was there. Maybe use another name.
Yeah, because I have this email in here that love you. You got another email you can use?
Mr. Spread.
You want me to use another one?
Well, it's saying that this email is in here under another username, so I don't know if you have filled out the form under another user or not.
What name you got in there? So he might be.
It's a lot of names.
Well, you scroll to him, I think I might have messed it up.
There he is, G.S. Spraggins. Number 14, see it?
Okay.
Running the down there. Donald
Spraggins. Right on the Donald. So, I'll fix that for you.
You hit the wrong key.
Oh, that's right. So, I can't change the username, but I can change the name.
Okay.
So, the username is D. Spraggins.
So, it's D. Spraggins?
Yeah. Okay. If you want, if you had another email, then I could just create you a good
one. I don't know.
Okay, let's do that.
This last name, first name, at gmail.com.
Okay.
Would you want to delete that?
So R. Spraggins.
Spraggins Ronald.
You said Spraggins Ronald?
Oh. And Gmail.
Mr. Spraggins, you got your kid named Franco?
It's almost of a big family.
Yeah.
It's
your favorite big one. Too. Yeah, I know Franco Spraggins has his favorite too.
So it's still being cross-pollination 2017?
Yes, sir.
So you're in there. Who said Tyler?
I think I saw Tyler.
See ya.
Go to the other page. Right.
I'm not sure who won.
What is that?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Set your password?
No, go ahead and reset it to, what's cross-pollination 2017?
Yeah.
And then the user was just, I'll see what the user is in a second. I'll put that in.
Yeah, do mine too.
Junior, are you using the dash and cross-pollination or just one word?
For the password, you mean?
No. He's getting all in one word.
All one word?
Yes, sir. It's all in one word.
You said you're too big?
Please, sir. That way.
Now, what was my use before you talked about?
T, but your first initial last name.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
You look out of the tree to keep right at the bottom. That ain't
You're being recorded, Mr. Owens.
Yeah, I mean, Mr. Julian Kidd, get my screen back.
I thought you know you let that guy marry you this evening.
How we what? Let me see a minute.
Just look out of here, what it is.
Oh, you need a website again?
That's the website?
Yes, website.
ILBCC B2B.com. So Illinois Black Chamber of Commerce, business to business. So ILBCC B2B.com.
The number two?
Yes, the number two. B, the number two. B.
ILBCC B2B.
And BCC, she's right.
BCC.
Excuse me.
B2B.com.
All right, guys, I'm going to jump right in. If you were here for my previous workshop on customer service, you may remember my name, but just for a quick introduction, my name is Bill Owens. I am a partner and chief development officer for Crimson Technology Group. I have over 20 years of experience in sales management, project management, dealing with high-end negotiations. Don't want to bore you guys. We kind of talked about it before. I want to try to be a little bit fun, and we're focusing on sales management, but specifically negotiation skills as they fit inside of sales management. And in order to really do this effectively, I have to be really honest with you. Negotiation, just selling the sales has a lot of, you know, they're like cousins of each other, brothers of each other. So everyone cannot necessarily, like we talked about in the previous workshop, cannot necessarily sell something, and everyone can't necessarily negotiate. Now you can learn to be a good negotiator, and learning how to negotiate will help you as you manage, do sales management or account management. So like we did before, I think it's best to have an open discussion, try to keep things more realistic to the things that we deal with in the city of Chicago, in our neighborhoods, in our respective business. And so like before, at any time, just kind of chime in because we'll get more out of it. At the end of the workshop today, I will be emailing Mr. Julian Kidd three questions that I'm going to develop from this conversation, because really I want to hear from you, because everyone's going to have a little bit of a different perspective as we move forward, okay? All right, so our objectives today, remember this guy, is like I said, this is so similar to what we did before. Some images are the same. I did use some different images. I wanted to make sure that you could see when you looked at both slide decks, there are some relationships. So we see the guy hitting his head again. You know, understanding your customer. We want to try and do that as an objective. Again, know your goal, and I'll explain that in a second. And listening is most important. Believe it or not, that is going to be something that we're all probably going to talk about, drive home over and over again. Now, why did I say know your goal? Okay, we may be a Mr. Kid shop thinking we can get some discounts on brakes, right? That's in our head. He's just trying to get his job done, get things done with us, and he may see that we need something else done. He may say, hey, you know, your trans is blowing out. Give me anything. So there may his discussion trying to convince us of what's good for us with that automated service, that is a negotiating skill, especially if you're only coming in and, man, I just need this brake job. But because he knows he's trying to be good by you, he's just trying to make sure you don't run out there on the road and, you know, you get stalled. So, but in our communities, as we know, sometimes things are real. People just want to get in and out. I don't want to hear what you're talking about, blah, 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 blah. So you have that type of more transactional type of situation. Then you have what you deal with when you're starting your own business, or when you are a startup, is contract negotiation. You know, knowing your goals there. B2B negotiation. So you, what's your name again, Ms. Reed?
Simone.
Simone. So I'm not sure, what is your business?
Excalibur.
Okay, okay, and what do you do?
It's a lounge.
It's a lounge? And what does it, what do I do with, at your lounge? I know what it is. I mean, just act like I'm just Joe Blow off the street. So what, if you're going to try to get me to come to your lounge, what would you tell me about your lounge to make me?
I would tell you all of the services we provide in terms of what we offer for having a gathering, blues night that we have on Saturdays, karaoke. I'll just tell you.
Wow, you just sold me. Guess what, Simone? You have music. Guess what I have? I have a band. See, right? So now I'm listening to what you're saying, right? So then for me, if I'm trying to sell what I offer to you, I have to continue to negotiate, see if there's a need, right? So you have a B2B, going back to actually listening to that URL, a negotiation, it becomes a B2B negotiation. It can come into play as well. So a lot of it comes into listening. So the last thing is the most important. So that's why I say understanding your customer. So you may not even have any interest in anything that I'm talking about. You know? You may not. You're like, I don't need a band. I got a guy with it, you know. Or I don't need this. But in listening to me and us listening to one another, you may hear there's something that you can use or need, and you borrow from that. So I'm using it on that level, but it can be higher level. So if you're in contract negotiation, presently, in my day, I'm sitting up working on this huge, huge contract. I'm going back and forth with someone that doesn't want to go lower on their points. But my goal is to what? To try and get this lower, because obviously I make more money. So I have to listen to what they need to see if I can give a little bit there, and then we can meet each other halfway. And we're going to see you a little later in a slide why that's kind of funny, because so someone we all know made a famous quote about that. So about actually what they feel negotiation is. In business, as in life, you don't get what you deserve, you get what you negotiate. That's by Chester Karas. Where are you at? Where are you trying to go? What are you willing to give today to gain tomorrow? So these are questions I want everyone to kind of keep in the back of their mind. Now again, remember, in order for me to give what I want to give to Mr. Kidd today, I'm asking you guys to kind of talk to me about real life situations. Have you ever been in a situation where you needed a service or you needed a contract and you just didn't know where to begin, where to go? Has anyone had that yet? You know? And it, what happened with you if you're about to ask someone?
Well, my thing was more like, I guess, kind of being in limbo in terms of which route I wanted to take first.
Okay.
So, me and my sister wanted to open a boutique, a fashion boutique.
Okay.
And in terms of actually having a spot to do it and trying to find out what would be lucrative, because seems like it's a lot of people in these last few years doing that. You see so many opening and closing after tweet, and they don't really stay. So it's like, you need, what does your customer want? So
exactly.
In terms of like, you need parking and somewhere for them to park if it's on a busy street, and you need the right signage and things where people can see that you actually exist on the street with multiple places. So basically, what we've done is just go on like city websites and things of that nature, and kind of like teach ourselves, because we didn't really know anybody in that business per se. And then you have in the back of your mind, like, if they know that you're trying to start the same business there, and they probably won't give you the information that you need, because now you're like their competitor. You know?
Well, you answered it. You actually allude to the next slide. So you knew where you were at in that situation. You were starting out. You're like, okay, I know where I'm at. I'm trying to get here, but I'm afraid to talk to this person to try and get this information that I need. So what happened in that situation? Did you still pursue it, or are you and your sister still doing it?
Well, basically, we were like, okay, we'll just do like a mobile boutique. So like go around to barber beauty shops, different places on like Fridays and Saturdays where we know people.
So how do you get inside those barbershops? So well, you go to Julian Kidd's barbershop, he's got a new barbershop, 2 blocks away from where you are. You have your booth set up, you have this mobile booth. How do you get in the door to get into this barbershop?
Well, what I was doing is just going to people that I, the owners that I knew
that
those
you knew.
Places.
Okay.
And I got a good feedback on it, you know. And ultimately, though, we didn't really put as much into it as we said we were in the beginning because we have a lot going on. But I do think that it will flourish once we get all of those loose
little
ends
pieces
together. Yeah.
So you're still doing that business?
Well, yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to use you as an example. So you have your mobile business, mm-hmm. primarily like beauty shops and barbershops, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So where you're trying to go, obviously, you're trying to get your mobile businesses, as many of those similar businesses as possible, right?
Mm-hmm.
Am I correct on saying that?
Yeah.
So what? This is the part here that you're going to have to challenge yourself with, and everyone's got to think about this in their own business. What are you willing to give today to gain tomorrow? Because, give me an example. That's why I was challenging. You mentioned something that is key, because we talked about this in the last workshop, and most people do this. I know we did this with our business. You start with the people that you know. It's a lot easier. That's what we call warm, you know, warm contact. Mm-hmm. It's a lot easier for me to walk in, Mr. Kid, hey, Mr. Kid, I make this cake, blah, 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 but he may know I can't cook, but at least he'll give me the conversation, you know, because I know Mr. Kid, you know, anybody got his back, his back, his back, a cupcake. But what's hard to do, and I think you were kind of going that route, is going to, like, say, a Julian Kid's barbershop. So you have no knowledge of him, and it's then explain what you have that will benefit him. So, and that's what I'm going to challenge you to write down. So when I'm going to go around to a couple of people, Mrs. Spraggins, I'm going to challenge you. Tyler, I'll challenge you as well. I want you all to kind of think in the back of your mind, you know, if there's something I'm trying to accomplish, what is my goal that I'm trying to grow my business, what am I willing to give to get there? You understand? What am I, because it's, and when a give doesn't necessarily mean giving up money. It doesn't even mean giving up, it really isn't even giving up service. It could be time. It could be resources. It could be, you know, it could even just be having a guy that put a little tin of their business on something that you own. But you have to start somewhere, because negotiation a lot of times is the first person is willing to give a little bit and the other person willing to give. And at the end of the day, nobody kind of wins, you know. You try, and it also depends on who's in the position of power. If I'm a sales guy, and I'm trying to sell this guy right here, I already know one thing. He's operating from a higher position. So because of that, I have to do more listening to what he's looking for, and then try and meet that. So even in that situation, if you're knocking his door, just introduce yourself, and then just let, hey, I just want to get to know more about you, even though you're really in there trying to get your mobile thing in. Because once he starts opening up his mouth, he's giving you everything you need. Once he starts talking, you use that, and then you can start negotiating again. Yes?
What do you mean by when you approach him, he's at a higher position?
He is. If
the company?
No. Oh, he's a good point. No. What I mean by higher position is if I'm trying to sell a product or service, if I'm trying to sell my product, service, or business to Tyler, Julian, Mr. Kidd, yourself, Jay, anyone in this room, you all are in a higher position in that negotiation position that I'm in. And one of the biggest mistakes people have, and that's how sometimes you ever see people arguing and they're not good at selling things and negotiating, they actually think that they can tell you what to do. And I'm sure I've been around Julian before in business situations, and we've all been around people who've done that. So you have to walk in and leave your ego at the door. And when you're coming to do business with a Mr. Kid, say you're selling a car oil that he's never heard of in his life. He doesn't know you outside of this door before you walk in. He knows you to be an African-American woman, right? And you walk in his door, he's, hi, I just want to get to know more about what your business are. He may give you time to talk about it. He said, oh, wow. And once he opens up and you listen, say, hey, by the way, I have my own line of oil, blah, blah, blah. He may not need it, but he may say, you know what? Let me get 2 or 3 cans. You can hold, you know, you don't know where to go, but you have to be willing to listen. Because a lot of times what happens, we get in a position where we're so busy talking about our great service or our great idea that we're not listening to see what the person is finding value in. They may not care about nothing we're talking about. And I go back to something Mr. Kidd said in my workshop, it was right on point. A person may just do business with you because guess what, they buy black. But you maybe not gotten to know what they're about. You know what I'm saying? We may not know. And they may expect that of you too. But if you find that out, and then he may be like, okay, he let me listen and say, oh, they don't even buy from black folk. But then, you know what I'm saying? He may be turned off, but that's why you have to listen in those situations. That was actually a great question. So thanks for course correcting me. So this is more for much larger groups. So we kind of had a discussion, but I like to everyone to kind of just kind of think of times and challenges that they had trying to just discuss or continue on their sales. Is there any of the obstacles just going around the room that anyone has had? And maybe we can discuss that and we can kind of twist this exercise a little bit at a smaller group. I'll start right here. Have you had any situations where you wish that, hey, you know, it's not going where I want, or?
Dozens.
Okay.
Dozens. Plenty of obstacles. One of the biggest obstacles is being in a position, and I learned this from Tyler, being an expert at my craft, but not understanding not having the financial aptitude to understand that no matter how good your product or service is, you can't come $450,000 underneath what somebody expects to pay without them being skeptical about what's happening. You know, so even though you know that I'm making a ton of money, there's no reason for me to add that $450, and you know the situation I'm talking about, but the industry that we're in, there's no standardization. There's no way for anybody to go and look at a barometer and say, this is what should happen. It's just, I don't know anything about technology. It's IT, you're the expert, what do I need to do? So that's what people expect. And we went into it expecting to save the world. Like, no, we're gonna give it to you what it's supposed to be. And that turned out to be kind of a turnoff.
Right.
So now we charge people like they want to be charged, and we're getting better reception.
Yeah, it's funny you say that, because you're right. In our business, it is a wild, wild west, and that is an excellent point on why it's good to discuss, because we just brought up this something that is really true. Remember we were talking about negotiating from a higher and lower position? You can do that with price. That's absolutely true. Yes, sir?
You can finish your
point. Oh, yeah. You can do that with price. Because it goes back to listening again. Because I know the situation. It's something that we as a team, it was a learning experience for us as a team. And you have to listen to that value, and you can sell yourself short a lot of times. You know, and then the people would get undervaluing you if their first experience with you is, man, it's cheap. And they already in the back of their mouth, I have to use this kid because I hear from last session, and you all have to deal with the fact that we got to keep this real that we're black.
Right.
I mean, you know, that's why I'm trying to keep this back. You know, we always are kind of challenged with that. And especially when we deal with our own people. Because, you know, I learned from that last workshop. When Mr. Kidd brought up and he changed the direction for the better of my last workshop, it was true. Because when you're dealing with we have a different, you know what I'm saying? We have something a little bit different that we have to deal with, unfortunately. But if you know that going in, you can have a lot of wins. But give me a Jay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, one of the challenges that I wanted to talk about is dealing with sincerity. You're dealing with other B2B situations, and not always B2B, but people see a value. You present yourself, they see a value in you, but the sincerity on their end is not there.
Right.
You know, they see that you could be a, hey, they can help me with this or put me in a position to leverage against somebody else. It's a lot of that that you run into in the business world. And I think we've seen so much of it.
Yeah, we have, and that's another.
Is it just learning, having a better radar to kind of weed out when you think it's that type of situation, or how do you turn it around to make an advantage, even if you're not going to make a sale?
Excellent again point. It's funny, I'm going to answer that question, because you're right, we have had a lot of that. And I think it comes again back to listening, and also when you have a team, knowing your talents and your team. And this is, like, for me, just, so as you all know, we're the three of us are business partners. And I know my weakness is, because by nature, I'm a pleaser. I'm trying to please that person to get that sale. You understand? So because of that, I'm focused on just trying to keep the relationship going, being a good person, trying to keep the spirit going. There's also an opportunity there, rather than saying weakness is an opportunity for me. But we have to do, to your point, we have to do self-analysis. So me, what I know, because I have this one opportunity or weakness, for lack of a better word, I really rely on YouTube, on One Piece, and that you guys have a good ability to do this, is to, when all of Billy shows going, hey, look at you, dancing party is all fine, you guys have a good strength of having the ability to say, okay, this is fluff, this is garbage, this is a waste of money. You know what I'm saying? So that's part of it. You know, learning those strengths, that's actually a huge strength. Because then, in the background, you can, in those higher end negotiating situations, I know exactly what you're talking about. You can say, hey, you've done it to me. Hey, man, this ain't real deal. You know, good job, but, you know, this person is pulling our leg. But it goes back to something you said earlier, too. Believe it or not, even when we're getting, we don't get what we want, guess what happened to us? We got negotiated. We got hustled. Just keeping it real, that's the basis of the negotiation is we got hustled. You know, when somebody ends up getting everything they want and you don't get anything out of it, yeah, it was still a negotiation going, you gave something up. So you gave, that's sometimes, that's how it goes. Now, some of the best negotiators, I'm glad we have a woman in here, I used women before, women. They're dealing with women. Women negotiate by nature. They negotiate all day long on all different things. And so in that aspect, we have to, in group situations in business, is listening and knowing each other's strengths, and then actually is just making sure everyone has a defined role when they go into those situations when you get ready to negotiate. And as a matter of fact, I'm going to take 2 seconds on that, and I should have put a bullet point on that. And it's funny because it came going back and made me think about something when I did my master's degree. You have, in negotiation or groups, you should always have an assigned role, especially when you're going to go sit at the table with someone. It is very important. So, like, if you know you're going at the table and there's 3 people, you should say, this person is going to position. You may have someone who doesn't say a word. And the reason they're not saying a word, they're watching everything else that's going on. Just to make, just jotting down, and then someone else may be the technical expert. And then from that, you can walk away with a better deal. But you're absolutely right. We've dealt with politicians. We've dealt with businesses. We've dealt with school boards. And a lot of times, people are... They know that they're in that position of power. They know that we're in there. I want you to get this. So part of it is having a little bit more of a swagger about yourself. And not to be funny, it's almost have the Julian Kidd attitude is, I really don't need you. You know, that's Julian does that very well. But seriously. He does it in a professional way, in a very professional way.
That'd be dangerous.
It can be in certain situations, it can. Yes, sir, go ahead. Yes, sir.
The thing that I look at, and I'm listening to you.
Yes, sir.
One is, you got to understand who you negotiate with before you negotiate.
Yeah.
Because everybody negotiates. I don't care if you're 2 years old. Your son negotiates real hard.
Yeah.
And he knows where he has the level of power. Yeah. He knows that his granddaddy and his grandma don't know how to deal with that. He negotiated with you, Tony, because he know that it changes quick.
That's true.
You know, where I ain't gonna do what you do. But the problem that most minorities have as in negotiating is that we have a lack of experience.
Yes.
Every customer walk in your door is a negotiator. Yeah. If he's your age or older, he's a negotiator. 100,000 times. So you gotta figure out how am I gonna negotiate?
Yeah.
And the first thing you learn is you listen to him.
Yeah.
Maybe the first 3 or 4 words come out of his mouth. Tell you, this is not one I want to negotiate with.
Yeah.
This is a deal I don't want.
Yeah.
You ain't gonna make it.
Yeah, good point.
And
yeah.
If you listen, probably in 10 words, you know how to negotiate with a person.
I agree with that 1,000%.
It's just like the car, Billy. Sometimes I know I want to make this sale. I got a bad week going, I need to make this sale, and I'm listening to this person, and he can say 2 or 3 words, I know he ain't got no money. So, I don't need to make this sale, because I got to call my line right now for 3 weeks, because I did bad negotiation.
I
needed the money,
yeah.
And I said, well, this is $700, this is going to make my week. That was 3 weeks ago.
Yeah.
So the thing is that you have to listen very well to the people that you're trying to negotiate with, because everybody negotiates.
Yes, sir. I agree with
that. Some people know how to negotiate better than you,
yep.
And you will end up on the show me end of that stick.
Yes, sir.
But experience is going to make you better. So it ain't nothing wrong with being on the show me end stick a couple times.
Right.
Because this is going to make you on the other end at a later date. But if without experience, you can't negotiate. Just don't learn that. It ain't something that you come out in this world with.
But before we go to your sis, I want to say I agree with everything 1,000% what you just said. Without equivocation. That's exactly right. That's why I said listening is the main point. And he kept it real. And that's very true. But one of the first things they trained us, I could tell in the first 8 seconds if you were wasting my time or not. You really can't. That's absolutely true. You can't. Go right ahead. I'm sorry.
That's to my point, though, what you were saying. I used to work in a jewelry store, Whitehall, for like 4 or 5 years. And it was like, you look at those people that come in. You know, everybody wants to look at the fancy stuff and the shiny stuff, and they're like, oh, this is really pretty, you know. But two, you're there and you're working and you never make a sale. And you'll get stuck with somebody that wants you to pull everything out, try everything on, and then have them back one day. And then you got another salesperson where you may have been with this person 20 minutes, and then, you know, one of your customers that you probably serviced before comes in, and then they get them, and they always bad, and you get the sale. So you learn quick when you're in that type of business. Sometimes you may have to, make up questions to ask them, you know, and depending on what their answer is, you know, you'll know if they're just looking or if they're really serious about buying something. And then sometimes you would get men, they didn't really know what they wanted to buy for their wife,
right,
you know.
Right.
But if you could kind of them 4 or 5 questions and get a feel of what it is they want, and then it makes your job easier, because that would, like, at the end of the night, it's 20 minutes to leave it, and then you get some people
somebody show up.
You learn quick, though. So it's definitely about experience.
Yeah, I agree with you. This kid is right. Listening and having those, the times you fall like anything else. Right. That's funny. Is it alluded to it when he brought up being a kid? I was going to talk about that. It's kind of funny. Mrs. Spratt, you've been silent. You've had any situations similar, or?
I mean, no,
you would like to
I'm
share?
Just starting off, okay. So I haven't had those experiences, but I do live by, I listen to the person, and in a few minutes I can actually understand where the person's coming from, so I always have done that in my life.
You bought shoes, haven't you?
Yes.
Have you ever had somebody try to sell you some shoes that you really didn't want?
No,
I've
had
that.
Just
wait
till they get. Wait,
wait.
So they can't
see. Have you ever had somebody try to sell you something you ever didn't want?
Yes, of course.
How did they do it? Were they able to sell it to you?
A few times.
Yeah.
They're a good negotiator.
There you go. So what made you buy whatever that product was?
You know, sometimes you just like how the person is presenting themselves and presenting the product to you.
Uh-huh.
So it goes. I feel like it goes by sometimes the way that
you come off to a person.
Exactly, exactly.
You give out good vibes, sometimes that helps.
So you'd be willing to give that person some benefit to talk to them a little bit?
Yes. I mean, okay. The person comes to you respectfully.
So let me ask you this, and I'm going to ask Tyler. Did you feel like when you purchased things that you won, did you gain anything from that purchase? Did you lose anything? Or did you just look at it, okay, win-win, wash your hands up and walk away? How did you look at it in those situations?
I mean, I look at it as a win-win. I won't say that I gained anything, you know.
That's good. No, I'm just asking, because all of that means something. Yeah, that's pretty cool. Now, me personally, if I ask Brother Tyler, I was in a situation, I love my dad. It's funny, you get older, you don't realize how right your parents were until you get older, you know. And as I was younger, my dad used to always tell me, man, boy, you need these type of shoes. I'm like, man, I ain't gonna wear some Johnson & Murphy, never in my life. But I would wear some Johnson & Murphy and Florida shoes. He used to tell me all these different shoes. You know, I'm like, man, he taught me how to spin shine and shine with shoes and stuff. So I called him, I'll never forget, this was about 3 years ago. I was like, Dad, what was the name of that shoe place? He said, Johnson & Murphy. He said, I told you, you got to that age, you know. When you get some comfortable shoes on your feet, they look nice. He said, yeah, I said, my feet are killing me. I mean, he said, hey, they're real comfortable. He says, there's only a few really, like, stores that sell them, it's just the shoes themselves, you know, in Illinois. Otherwise, you get them online, or you may have to go into, like, a little regular department store. So I found one, I had to drive out to Oak Brook. So, just sharing with you guys, I'm with my wife. Now, this is part of negotiating. So, to Mr. Kidd's point, have a wife, you got to negotiate with her too, just to spend the money. That's number one. So, she was cool because she wanted to be out of some new shoes. And, you know, some of these brothers have met my wife, and she's tough, man. So, she was like, you know, you spending how much on shoes? I said, listen, you know. So, I'm negotiating, got that part done. I get the shoes. But now, I have a threshold. Because my wife, if I spend a dollar over $125, guess what's going to happen? I'm going to hit it all the way on the ride home, all the way back home. So I'm like, okay, I'm not spending, you know, no more, no less. I can't look at anything that goes over a certain dollar amount. This actually happened to me. Go out, have my wife with me. She's already upset because she didn't want to be in the store and she wanted to go shop for herself anyway. So I'm trying to keep her out of the store going, oh, they try to give her a couple dollars. She wouldn't have it because she knows the game. She says, none of my negotiating skills work. She's stuck on me like this, right? Guy comes out, first guy, to your point, rude, okay? He was a Caucasian guy. Rude, I don't think he thinks I had any money. I don't know what he thought. But it was one of those attitudes. I think he thought I was going to be wasting his time. Because I was like, hey, I would like to try out a couple of shoes, you know, blah, 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 whatever. And his whole attitude was kind of, you know, real stinky. So in the back, I was never going to get this guy on commission anyway. You know, that's in my mind. So I'm already now, I don't even want to spend the money. And my wife, now is getting happy because she knew I was thinking about not spending any money. But out the corner of my eye, I see a guy put some shoes up and some brother. I say, hey, brother, can you help me out? He said, yeah, sure, what's going on? He comes out and said, man, I'm just trying to find some shoes. And it was funny because my mood and the way I spoke to him changed because I could speak to him as a brother. I'm like, man, I got a wife with me. You know, she tripped. You know, he's dying laughing, cracking jokes. And now she's easing up because she's talking to a brother. He was super nice. He said, look at him. So he showed me what he had on his feet. I'm like, man, I like those. I said, you know, should I tell him, baby, you like those shoes? I said, I actually like those. She said, I can deal with how much? He said, well, these hit me for $140. I said, ah. I'm like, ah. I said, man, I got to stay, you know. He said, no. Go ahead and go back there and get those shoes. So he went out of his shoes. What do you think this guy did when he was talking to me the whole time? That it was different than the other guy had. That's still going to be very nice. What do you think? Anybody can guess what he did? It was real brilliant. You know what he did? Take a while, I guess. He didn't sell the shoes to me. He showed it to my wife because he was wise going to back with Mr. Kidd, you know, just having common sense. Because everything that he did when he came out, he spent more time showing the shoes. And I kind of picked up on what he was doing. And he said, yeah, I'm trying them all. He wasn't really talking to me. And he was just looking at me. He looked me in the back like that, like, I got you. You know, like, I got you. So he knew who he needed to sell the shoes to. He knew I was with Dave for it. But he knew, hey, this is the person you show this to. This is what I'm going to spend my time with. But it goes back to what Mr. Kidd said. You know, it is listening and, you know, and just using common sense. Because it's true, we negotiate since this side. So I wanted to have this open dialogue. It's kind of funny. And I was going to talk about it. We're no longer wanting to be little kids. You know, and my mother sent me this picture. Why she loves it, I have no idea. Boy, I remember she used to pick my head. It would feel like she was taking my head off my neck back in the day. Which I wanted to have open discussion and just kind of say what Mr. Kidd already kind of alluded to. We negotiate as children, and now we don't want to be little kids. We want to learn from that, you know, and learn now to have those skills. So it's actually kind of cool to hear him say that, because it lets me know that I was kind of on the right track. Because as a kid, I was always trying to get cookies and do all, you always do, you're absolutely right. You're sort of always were doing it.
Yeah, I had
to negotiate
the
game,
man.
But
my kids didn't want to get in.
Oh,
for Jack. The part is, he thought that the negotiation was for him. Because he walked in and opened a box and ate cookies.
That's what you said.
My man.
You invited.
Did they get cookies?
Yeah, but those are Jeffrey's daughter's cookies. It wasn't my cookie.
You invited, so. Jack called you straight out tonight. Don't worry about it.
That's even better negotiation. And no negotiation. So this slide is familiar because I actually took this slide from our workshop because it still kind of applies. And we kind of talked about this. Understanding your customer. You use that term. So what I'm enjoying about this conversation with our group is everyone is saying everything kind of how I was thinking anyway. You know, so it's really cool that everyone understands it. You said this actually too, since you said, who are your customers? You said, who are your customers? You know, who am I dealing with? You know, so what we're seeing here is what we showed in our last workshop is actually that lean cycle that we used before. You know, when we get an idea, we build it, we create the product, we measure it, you get the data, then you learn from that, and then you start the whole process. It's just something that becomes behavioral based. Believe it or not, you have to do that itself. The same thing with your negotiation skills and the things that you're trying to sell. You should always be measuring it. So if you don't have the benefit of business partners, just do some self-reflection. You know, it could be just like, man, why did I talk to that fool today? I knew in the first 8 seconds that I was a waste of my time. How much money did that cost me? Learn from it. Going back to Mr. Kidd, just know this is the science behind it, but the common sense of it really is what Mr. Kidd said. Really it is. You know, this is how you get a degree in what is common sense that we learn every day. That's the reality of it. We really all do these methodologies, we can call it whatever, but at the end of the day, it's really common sense. So you have to, when you're in groups or small business groups like ours, we should have the idea and then we should challenge people after everything that we do. It should be, and we kind of do that anyway. Hey man, we missed this, what do you think happened, this and that. You know, we do it in an informal process. But you can get it formalized depending on how big you're trying to grow, how you want to grow. But if you're an operational one, you kind of just measure some of the things you're doing. You said this too, sis. What are you trying to sell? You know, it could be some rings over the counter. You'd be trying to get a contract. So getting a contract, and we're going to go back to this in 1 second, is different than how you're going to try to sell a product. And then presenting a service is kind of a hybrid depending on what type of service you're building. Now, depending on what type of mindset you have can make or break your business. So I want to take some quick time right here. If you're positioning a product which is traditionally a transactional sale, and you think of that sale as transactional, there's nothing wrong with that. If strategically you do what we talked about in the first workshop, and you try to get that repeat business from that customer you sold to. And if you all remember, it was Mr. Kidd, another gentleman we kind of talked about, he was sitting up front, that repeat business is real important, getting the referrals and things like that from that first workshop. So that's the key. So when you're negotiating, so give an example. If sister's trying to sell me her jewelry, I buy a diamond ring for my wife. It could be that you're just real pleasant. You take, like you said, like I'm a guy, half the time if I want to get something, it's either gym shoes, a shirt, sweater, I know what I want. Outside of that realm, I may say, hey, sis, I know my wife likes the color green and red. Could you help me out? You know, it could be, and then, you know, I'm sure you deal with a lot of men, and then they're having you design for their wife because they're trusting you. But if you have a pleasant disposition, I know the next time my wife, you know, our anniversary's coming up, and if I bought a ring for you from you or some earrings on her birthday, immediately what I'm going to think is, oh, I need to go see your girl Simone. Chantel love that jewelry. I'm not wasting no time. She's going to hook me up. So now you have repeat business for me, and that wasn't a one-off sale for you. So now you have less time with me, even if you're dealing with the jerky guy who's wasting your time for 20 minutes. I can offset it because I'm your repeat customer. Because when you see me, oh, that's Billy. I know he's going to buy. What you want, baby? Boom, 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 boom. I'm in and out. This is the same thing probably with Mr. Key. He may have people he knows are going to pay. He knows they're going to get his business from. So for all of those people, when he has the lack of a better word, the jackasses that come in, you know, and curse you out, act crazy, you do have the one or two good ones. Those repeat customers. And that's what's cool when you know what you're trying to sell. Now, where it changes is contracts, and depending on the contract or service, you have to have the ability to really, 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 you're listening, you have to be granular, and not only your listening skills, but your ability to provide value, not only in the service or product that you have, but the time that you're taking from that person. I think those are very, very important. You agree?
That drove me crazy today.
Yeah.
I went to buy tires and rims.
Okay, what happened?
And one of my tires, the rim cracked like 2.5 weeks ago. And I went to Mr. Lee Foreign on Jefferson, and that guy, he gave me a spare just so I could get where I need to go because the guy who does the rims and stuff wasn't there. So I'm like, so annoyed driving around on this tire because it was a Mercedes tire off of one of those older cars.
So yes.
It wasn't the same height, the same size or nothing. Right. And I can feel the car dragging when I'm driving. It's like I'm wasting gas, you know?
Right.
And I'm like steady calling around and went to 5, 6 different places. I'm like, this is the hardest thing I do in life is to find out, just to pick tires and rims for this car. So then I go and yesterday, and then I went to Exotic on Western.
Okay.
And then the guy was like the younger guy, was cool. But the first time I went, the older guy, he was pretty decent, but it was almost time to close. I was like, you know what, I'll come back, you know, another day. Came back the next day. He wasn't there. It was another guy. Long story short, I took my car there at 10:30 this morning, and I just got it back like 10 minutes before I got here, okay?
Wow.
When they told me that it was only gonna take about an hour, okay?
Wow.
First of all, my thing is I'll come to you and I'll say, look, I need X, Y, and Z, and I got a budget.
Right.
Right, and then I'll tell you what my budget is. But oh, they weren't trying to hit it.
Oh, so stop, what were you trying to do right there? Go back to Mr. Kia said.
Mm-hmm.
Look what you just did. Yeah, I know he deals with that. If she came in, first thing he said, this is my budget. You already doing what? You negotiated from the job.
Yeah, I need you to find what I want in this price range.
Right.
Make
right.
It happen, right?
Right.
You're a professional. I'm the customer.
Right.
And this is what I need.
But that's not always true because
right.
You can't always go by what the person comes and says what I got. You may have to make the decision. I can't deal with you.
Right.
Yeah.
This is my price.
Right.
And I can't. And if you go beyond that price, let's say less than what you probably get, it's going to be a problem.
Yep.
A good example is, if you close at 5 o'clock, and I don't care what happens, 5 o'clock is when you're supposed to leave, because anytime that you take on something after 5 o'clock, it's going to be a nightmare for you. But the question I had was, how are you in a negotiation? Is it bumbling, or do you ease into internet, or how do you go about? I'm just asking you that part. I know how I'm gonna deal with it, but I want to know, since you seem like a type of person that's a little bit more kind than most business people.
No, there's a lot. It's a multifaceted. So it depends on. That's a great question. It depends on who I'm dealing with. And what risk is involved. So I'm a very, there's a whole other side to me. So like, that's a great point. So if I'm in a business situation and I know that I'm talking to you and I got an opportunity to sell a $2 million contract that I'm going to make, I'm going to bring in 15% on a contract, and then I'm going to bring in probably another $40,000 straight out of that deal. Right?
Let me stop you, because I wasn't talking about that one.
I'm going to give you both. I know exactly what you said, Mr. Kidd. No disrespect. You're 100% right. It's two different situations. If I know I have something big like that, and I know you, I will take a lot on and be kind for a little while, because why? I got a lot more that, you know, I can deal with. But if it gets to a point where I can't do business with you, then I'm done. I'm done with you. I'm done with you real professionally. I never let anybody have enough power over me to change me being me. So if I'm done with you, I'll be done with you with the person you see right here. But you know that I'm done. I said, I'll be honest, like, hey, it's been great. I just can't do business with you. I'm sorry. You know, this is not going to work for you or not. And that's it. It's not a conversation. It's nothing. If ain't someone else gets abrupt, hey, we're done. I maybe I can refer you to someone else. Boom, boom. I try to always leave.
You're being recorded, Mr. Owens.
Yeah, man. You know, Mr. Julian Kidd, get my screen back.
I thought you wanted you to go,
man.
Oh,
I see.
You
do, man.
There you go.
I know I got it.
Billy, I don't even know you let this guy
hurt
you this evening.
How's he button? Let me see him, man.
Oh, you need a website again?
That's
your
website?
Yes, website. ILBCCB2B.com. So Illinois Black Chamber of Commerce, business to business. So ILBCCB2B.com.
Cool. That number two?
Yes, the number two. B, the number two. B.
ILBCCB2B.
All right, guys, I'm going to jump right in. If you were here for my previous workshop on customer service, you may remember my name, but just for a quick introduction, my name is Bill Owens. I am a partner and chief development officer of Crimson Technology Group. I have over 20 years of experience in sales management, project management, dealing with high-end negotiations. Don't want to bore you guys. We kind of talked about it before. I want to try to be a little bit fun, and we're focusing on sales management, but specifically negotiation skills as they fit inside of sales management. And in order to really do this effectively, I have to be really honest with you. Negotiation, just selling to sales has a lot of, you know, they're like cousins of each other, brothers of each other. So everyone cannot necessarily, like we talked about the previous workshop, cannot necessarily sell something, and everyone can't necessarily negotiate. Now, you can learn to be a good negotiator, and learning how to negotiate will help you as you manage, do sales management or account management. So, like we did before, I think it's best to have an open discussion, try to keep things more realistic to the things that we deal with in the city of Chicago, in our neighborhoods, in our prospective business. And so, like before, at any time, just kind of chime in because we'll get more out of it. At the end of the workshop today, I will be emailing Mr. Julian Kidd three questions that I'm going to develop from this conversation. Because really, really, I want to hear from you, because everyone's going to have a little bit of different perspective as we move forward, okay? All right, so our objectives today, and reminisce, guy, is, like I said, this is so similar to what we did before. Some images are the same. I did use some different images. I wanted to make sure that you could see when you looked at both slide decks, there are some relationships. So we see the guy hitting his head again. You know, understanding your customer. We want to try and do that as an objective. Again, know your goal, and I'll explain that in a second. And listening is most important. Believe it or not, that is going to be something that we're all probably going to talk about drive home over and over again. Now, why did I say know your goal? Okay, we may be a Mr. Kid shop thinking we can get some discounts on brakes, right? That's in our head. He's just trying to get his job done, get things done with us, and he may see that we need something else done. He may say, hey, you know, your trans is blowing out. It could be anything. So there may his discussion trying to convince us of what's good for us with that automated service, that is a bit of a, that is a negotiating skill, especially if you're only coming in and, man, I just need this brake job. But because he knows he's trying to be good by you, he's just trying to make sure you don't run out on the road or, you know, you get stalled. So, but in our communities, as we know, sometimes things are real. People just want to get in and out. I don't want to hear what you're talking about, blah, 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 blah. So you have that type of more transactional